the wonderful world of empirical research and study. And that just really kind of changed my life.
I was always good in science. I wanted to have a career in STEM. You know, I wanted to be in the hospital, and my aspiration was to go to med school.
One scientific article that's about, you know, 15 to 20 pages long, I would literally spend hours and hours diving in, having as much fun as, you know, you might find yourself exploring like a new vacation spot.
Then I applied to the PhD program again in psychology at Columbia, and this time I was accepted, and I just couldn't believe it. This was a best case scenario. I had never had a best case scenario happen in my entire life until then.
Body is actually locked inside a cage, it's actually pretty difficult to not also allow your mind to be locked inside prison as well. Learning about diabetes was a way for me to break free from that psychological prison.
You can be a scientist, you can do it, and we're gonna teach you how. And I just started to feel like, oh wow, I might have a future that doesn't look like a cell.
Being incarcerated is something totally different. You have to have a heightened sense of awareness of your environment. Your survival depends on it. So I think that the power of observation becomes something that we unintentionally become great at.
So I'm 17 years old. I'm selling drugs just to support myself and support my brother. And I was sentenced to 6 years by a judge for selling MDMA to an undercover officer. The judge says, I'm giving you this sentence because of the dangers of this drug and the amount of people overdosing for this drug. I thought it was warranted. And so while I'm in prison, this is what's going through my mind. When I get out, I'm gonna study this drug, I'm gonna study the dangers, and I'm gonna warn people about the harmful consequences of using this drug. So we do studies where a drug is given to participants under controlled lab settings, and we study the immediate and the delayed effects of repeated MDMA dosing in humans, and we didn't find any drastic increases in heart rate and blood pressure or negative mood in the days following the repeated dosing. So I just felt like I had been lied to my whole life about the real effects of drugs, like what drugs actually do and don't do. And then I learned that MDMA could be administered safely in laboratory settings, and that MDMA-related overdoses are just especially rare. Drug misinformation can lead to just harsh punishments.
When college classes were offered in prison, for me, it was kind of a do-over, right? I was able to take an environmental science course while I was there. I absolutely enjoyed it. What was probably the most important thing about those courses was that they really just laid this foundation for me that had much more to do with study habits, right? I got straight A's in every one of those classes, and it just cemented this idea that maybe when I got out, I might be successful there as well. I think I can ever learn everything about addiction, but I can definitely do my best in the short time that I have in the rest of my life to try and do that. I'm going to focus on one challenge, the box on college applications that asks about an applicant's criminal history.
We know that 60% of people, when they get to the question on the application of, have you been convicted of a felony? Are you formally incarcerated? Will just stop and won't even go past that question. I was denied almost immediately. I got a rejection letter back. Like, I had no clue that a collateral consequence of incarceration was a denial to education. So I was like, I wonder what would happen if I just unchecked the box. And I got an almost immediate acceptance letter. In 2017, we began work on what is known as ban the box on college applications, and that became law here in the state of Louisiana, making Louisiana the first state to pass that type of legislation.
That's potentially thousands and hundreds of thousands of people coming out of prison behind me that now are not going to face that particular barrier and hopefully will go on and apply to college and to get into college and do incredible work and be able to add to STEM, add to science as we know it.
STEM Ops stands for STEM Opportunities in Prison Settings. This is a National Science Foundation funded collaboration to broaden participation in STEM education and careers for people who are currently and formerly incarcerated. An analogy that I often use is it's hard to really tell someone to shoot for the stars when they've never seen the sky because they've been locked in a basement all their life. So when they see people that have been through the challenges that they've been through doing these things, like astrophysics and information technology, it makes it more real. So we really go through this process of lifting them up and helping them see that they already have all the skills needed to be successful. You know, we do that by providing mentoring, by providing employment opportunities, providing educational opportunities, putting individuals in this network where they can see themselves as scholars.
One of my professors, he kind of referenced that I wasn't like everybody else, I guess, who had been to prison. And that didn't feel right. I was like, no, I'm not an exception to the rule. I'm not exceptional. I left behind thousands of women who are smarter and deserve the same chance that I now have.
I assure you, I was locked up with people who worked much harder than me, who were much smarter than me. I was just lucky enough to get opportunities afforded to me that other people didn't have afforded to them.